and welcome everybody to the Solano College Sports Network for a brand new edition of On Campus. My name is Cameron Anderson, here with a very special guest, the professor here for the Solano College Sports Network, Greg Poff. Thank you so much for joining me today, Poff.
Well, really cool being here, Cameron. You know, being in charge of the sports broadcasting program, I've only done one interview previously to this, so it's kind of nice getting in front of the camera, having an opportunity to talk about the sports broadcasting program. And it's great to be here with you doing your interview as you're winding up your career here in the Solano College Sports Broadcasting Program.
Well, this is an honor for me, being this is only your second interview, and I'm really excited about this. So to start things off, I want the audience and I to get a little know a little bit more about yourself, maybe where you grew up, your beginning interest in sports, and your educational journey, maybe life journey leading up to becoming a professor.
Yeah, I grew up in Southern California in Long Beach, great place to grow up. And my earliest memories of sports are actually going to Los Angeles Rams football games at the Coliseum. And I mean, this is back in the late 50s and early 60s. My dad actually got season tickets for both of us. Right? Wow. As a little kid, you don't appreciate it as much, but right on the 50-yard line, I got to see Jim Brown play, who just passed away this past week. One of my favorite all-time players was watching Johnny Unitas with the Colts. And one of my favorite players for the Los Angeles Rams was a running back by the name of Dick Bass, who I later find when I move up here is from Vallejo, California. Wow. So that was pretty cool as well. So kind of just grew up. It was really my father was into sports. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, going to Rams games, going to Dodger games. We didn't go to any Laker games, come to think of it, but they were always on TV. So kind of grew up in Long Beach, Southern California, and got into sports really because my dad was into sports. And then, you know, from the time I can remember as a little kid, you know, I was either, you know, I had a bat in my hand, throwing a football, playing basketball. Of course, you have that great weather in Southern California as well. So it was just kind of, it was my family and my family's interest in sports that really led me into enjoying sports as well.
Was there one sport in particular that maybe grabbed your attention first, maybe your first love?
Yeah, I would say probably football.
Okay.
And I remember when I was a kid, one Christmas, I got an electric football game. And I mean, this is back in the mid 60s, but essentially it was just this board and it was made out of metal. You plugged it in and it was a football field. And then you had these little players and you line them up, you get the decals of your favorite teams. Right. I had the LA Rams playing the Dallas Cowboys, get the number. And back then you didn't have to worry about changing numbers all the time because you didn't have free agency.
Right.
But essentially the game was, you just turn the button on and it vibrates. And then you just kind of hope your guy with the little felt ball would be able to make some yards and stuff. So because of that, I just really enjoyed the game of football. And gosh, I can remember being in elementary school, being on a flag football team, and, you know, drawing up plays, X's and O's and things like that. My dad also coached football for a little bit, so I had a little bit of that coaching bug in me as well, I guess. Even as a kid, I was the one always trying to draw up the plays for everybody on the team.
So that leads into my next question. Did you want to be a football coach growing up? What were some of your career plans as a kid leading into what could actually be a career for you?
Yeah, as a kid, that was something I always thought I would get into, would be coaching football. And it wasn't until I really got into high school, and then I found out, wait, we got to practice all year round? I mean, I grew up in Southern California. I also grew up surfing. And, you know, that was something we did every summer. My family, we'd go down to Mexico for a couple weeks, surf down there. And then once I got into high school, and I was playing high school football, it was like, well, Poff, we're practicing all summer, you know, all kinds of drills. And then I finally got to the point, and I kind of regret it, but I quit playing football in high school just because I didn't like the year-round practice and the commitment to one thing.
Were you playing other sports as well in high school?
Yeah, I played basketball, and I really liked baseball, but I could not hit a curve. And so I really had trouble at the plate. So really, for me, it was football and basketball were my two sports that I played.
So I'm curious, what are some of your hobbies, some things that you do in your leisure time when you're not in the classroom teaching?
Well, I like to surf. I'm mm-hmm. getting up there in years, so I don't surf nearly as much as I used to. Mm-hmm. And I've been up here in Northern California, gosh, for 30 years now. And once I made the move up here, a little farther from the ocean,
yeah.
water's a little colder. There's probably more sharks up here.
Yeah.
So once I moved to Northern California, I tend to travel places to go surf. So usually, you know, I'm down in Mexico over the semester break mm-hmm. between the fall and the spring semester. And then usually in the summers, my wife's from Fiji. So we try to get to Fiji and spend a couple weeks there. And I've got my surf spots there that are still pretty cool.
When did you find passion for communication? Obviously, you have a great history in public speech and debate. When did that sort of click for you?
You know, it's funny, but growing up, one of my favorite TV shows was Leave It to Beaver.
Mm.
And one of my favorite actors or favorite characters on mm-hmm. that show was a guy by the name of Eddie Haskell. You probably haven't heard of him.
Mm-mm.
But he was Wally's friend. Wally was Beaver's older brother. But that kid could talk his way into and out of anything. And it was really kind of watching that show that I learned the value of communication.
Mm.
And then I noticed too that I kind of had a gift for being able to talk and motivate people. And so I really learned at an early age that communication is a valuable skill, especially when it comes to conflict resolution. I didn't get in any fights in high school because I was able to talk my way out of a lot of different situations.
So going into high school, talk to us a little bit about your journey with public speech and debate. I know you don't always like to talk about yourself, talk yourself up, but maybe give the audience a little bit about what you've done with public speech and debate. Maybe list some of your own accolades.
Well, in high school, it wasn't much. In fact, I remember going to my 25-year reunion mm-hmm. and telling people, now that I'm a college professor, and their response, Poff, you didn't even go to school. And so I was a terrible high school student.
Mm.
I barely graduated. Mm-hmm. In fact, I had to go to summer school after my senior year in high school to get my diploma.
Mm.
And really the one reason I did is because my parents had got me new rims for my 67 Impala, and I wasn't going to get those rims unless I went to that summer class and actually got my diploma. So I was not a good high school student. Just, you know, a kid, there's other stuff to do.
Yeah.
Didn't really see the value in education at that point. So it wasn't until a little bit later, after I turned 21, it, really cool opportunity. 1976, it was the bicentennial year, and I read about this group that was going to actually go on covered wagons and go across the United States from San Diego to Philadelphia. And I just turned 21, didn't have much going on. I thought, man, that'd be a cool way to see the country. At that point, I hadn't been east of the Colorado River. And so when I went on that trek, it took 6 months, but part of the deal was when we would get to a town and kind of circle our wagons in the park or wherever they had us, members of the public, of the community we were staying in would come mm-hmm. out, and we'd do little shows and skits and stuff like that.
Okay.
And so that's where I first kind of learned about being just in front of an audience, talking in front of an audience, acting in front of an audience. And that's really where I kind of learned about performing in front of others. And I always tell my students in public speaking, look, public speaking is a performance just like acting. You learn the lines of your speech just like you're learning lines in an actual play. So it was really that wagon train that kind of shifted my focus on communication. And then when I was done with that, mm-hmm. I thought, you know, I really should think about going to college and maybe doing something in communication. I'd been out for a couple of years. And so that kind of motivated me to go back to college. Started at Long Beach City College back, gosh, this was in 1980, and had my first public speaking class, liked it, had another communication class. Then I learned that, hey, they also have this thing called competitive speech and debate, joined the speech team, and did really well. I was the national champion in 1983 in what's called impromptu speaking. It's just organized BS. Essentially what they do is you get a slip of paper, you have three quotations,
mm-hmm.
you have 2 minutes to select one of the quotations, and then turn around and give a 5-minute organized structured speech. And so then it was like, oh, there's a way to organize my BS? That was really cool. So I did really well in that. And then I was able to kind of catapult off that national championship to be able to go right into coaching the next year, even though I was just starting at Long Beach State, still had two more years to go. Mm-hmm. Long Beach City College hired me as an assistant coach, and I started coaching back in 1984, and that's how I kind of fell into. Grew up wanting to be a football coach. I end up for 30 years coaching speech and debate teams.
Where do you think you found your confidence in being able to stand up in front of an audience and perform and really public speaking? I mean, I know taking your public speaking class, one of the first things you show is that Seinfeld clip where he says that public speaking is the number one fear and death is number two. So obviously there's a lot of fear in being able to speak publicly. Do you think you always had some type of confidence in doing that, or did you really have to work on that? And if you did have to work on that, what were some of the tips or things that you did to work on that?
Yeah, I think I just enjoyed being the center of attention, to be honest with you. And it, with speech and debate, it's like you didn't have to go to a party and drink and have a lampshade on your head to get attention. You could do it just through talking and trying to communicate more effectively with others. And so I learned early on that communication is a really important skill, because if you can do it well, then you can motivate others. You can actually change behavior. You can focus on trying to get things done. So I really saw it as a very unique but very powerful skill. And I think that's what attracted me to communication and really focusing my life on communicating.
So with communications, you obviously became a communications professor. So talk to us a little bit about how you made the switch from public speech to and debate to communications.
Yeah, so really to get a teaching job in the field of communication, it helps if you have something kind of on the side that you can do that you can add to whatever school you're applying to. And so I was really lucky. I actually got hired as a tenured track communication professor the semester before I completed my master's degree. And the only reason I was able to do that is I went from a pretty successful career as a competitor on the community college level. I went right into coaching, and then I had some early success as a coach. My very first speech team at Long Beach City College, we took sixth at the national championship tournament. Wow. And so that just opened up a lot of doors for me. And so I ended up getting hired at El Camino College in the spring of 1987. I was still working on my master's degree, but back then you could get a temporary teaching certificate where you could teach on the college level even if you didn't have your master's degree. That doesn't even exist anymore. And so then when I started coaching at El Camino, I was there for a year and a half. I was an assistant coach to a really good head coach there, but we had a lot of success in those first 2 years. And then I was able to get hired as the full-time head coach at Riverside Community College in 1989. That was a community college that had no speech and debate for the last 10 years. I was able to go there, and by the second year, we were in the top five in the nation in debate. So I just had a lot of success early on, and it wasn't that I was smarter or better than anyone. The thing I learned early on with coaching speech and debate is you don't have the physical differences that you have when you're coaching sports. Like, you know, you might be coaching, you know, a football team, and I don't care how hard the kids work, you're going to find other kids that are just bigger, faster, they have more talent.
Right.
But with speech and debate, through hard work, you can kind of close that competitive gap more. And so I really learned that there's no real secret to success. You just outwork the competition. And I know for me, my real success as a speech and debate coach was based on the fact that I really learned how to organize and run an efficient practice. And I knew that if I could get more out of my students in that 2 hours every afternoon that we were practicing, that would help us to be more competitive. And so, really with communication and my success, it wasn't that I was smarter than anyone else. I just would try to outwork everyone else. And I tried to emulate that with the students so they would follow that and really learn that, hey, if you want to be successful in life, you just put your head down, you start grinding, and you go to work.
Wow, that's awesome to hear. I'm curious how, obviously we're here in the sports broadcasting studios, How did the sports broadcasting program come about? I mean, obviously this is a really rare thing to find at a community college level, and I believe it was one of the first in California to be able to have a sports broadcasting program and earn a certificate from it. How did that whole process come to be?
It was really a fluke. You know, I look back at where we're at now and how it started. It was in the spring of 2007, and I was still coaching speech and debate here at Solano. And my youngest son had moved up, and he'd started going to community college, got him on the speech and debate mm-hmm. team, but really he just wanted to do something that was involved in sports. I kind of convinced him, hey, do this. You'll develop your communication skills, and then that could maybe lead into getting a job in sports, maybe as a broadcaster. Mm-hmm. But in 2007, that was the second semester here, just out of the blue, I get a call from Bob Myers, who was the athletic director at the time, and he was talking to one of the computer instructors here who had played baseball for Solano. Solano had just kind of turned around their baseball team in 2007, mm-hmm. looked like they were going to get into the playoffs. Right. They got in 2006, 2007, even a better team. Mm-hmm. And so they wanted to figure out a way to maybe kind of just get an audio broadcast. And so the athletic director called me because I was in speech and debate communication. And so then I just go, well, my son's here and he really wants to, you know, get involved in sports. So long story short, he, along with Mark Cooper, that was the computer instructor. Mm. They called the first Solano baseball game, I think it was March 22nd, 2007. Wow. And I mean, they were recording it into a computer and then, you know, getting it later and then posting it on a website somewhere. And so for the next couple of years, we started doing more and more just audio only mm-hmm. tape recordings, not only of baseball, but the next fall we started doing football games. And then as we started looking for universities for my son to transfer to, it was just hard finding anything specific to sports broadcasting.
Right.
I was getting at the end of my coaching career. As soon as my kids were done, my last one came through in 2009, I was going to be done coaching forensics and speech and debate. And so I thought, well, maybe I can create kind of a sports broadcasting class in the communication studies department. And so that's what I did. I went, talked to my dean at the time and said, hey, here's what I'm interested in doing. And she kind of helped me get started. Long story short, I wrote a class. It was just communication. Actually, back then we were the speech department, not communication studies. Mm-hmm. It was speech 75. And that was our first communication class. And the cool thing, or sports broadcasting class, and the cool thing about that class, when we first offered it, you could take it up to three different times. Mm-hmm. Then a couple years later, new rules were passed where you can only offer a class one time. So that's where I had to get kind of creative and then write three more classes. And right. So that's when we went to the 75A, that's more in the broadcasting. And then we had the 75B, which focuses more on the TV production. And then we added the 80A and B that focus even more on production. So we got those four classes. Once we had that, then we put it together as a certified teaching or certified job program under the CTE guys here at Solano. And now you can get a certificate of achievement in sports broadcasting if you take those four classes, 75A and B, 80A and B, which translates to about 400 hours of hands-on experience, whether you want to be in front of the camera as a broadcaster or learning how to do all the video stuff. And it was during that time in 2011 where we made the jump and we started focusing more on video production as opposed to just doing the audio broadcast that we had done for the previous couple of years.
I'm curious, when you're a part of the broadcast, what is your favorite role? What is your favorite role? Is it running a camera, running the TriCaster, being on the mic?
Oh, I love being on the mic. Yeah, if I could, I would call every game.
Yeah.
It's just fun. And it's the best way to really enjoy a game if you're doing any kind of video or TV production. Yeah. And you know this, if you're, you know, working on a camera, you're running the video board, you're doing the instant replay, you don't really get to focus on the game. You have to focus more on your job. Even if you're on a camera, yeah. I mean, every camera has their own specific shots. But when you're broadcasting the game, and usually you've got the best seat in the house, you get to really watch and talk about what's happening on the field. And bottom line, and this is one of the first things that I tried to teach you when you started, is when you look at sports broadcasting, all it's really about is telling a story. Mm-hmm. You're a storyteller, and you get to shape the story as you see it. I just love being able to do that when it comes to sports. And sports, you couldn't ask for a better story.
Yeah.
Right? You had the victory, you had the tragedy, like last night, Lakers getting swept by Denver. Right? But still, you know, you're telling a story, and you never know how it's going to end.
If there's an incoming student who's either watching this or is at Solano and is interested here in the program, what would you tell that student?
As far as the program and what it can...
What they would look forward to if they joined the class?
I think, one, you're going to have some fun. I mean, essentially, you have a class and you're involved in sports. And obviously, most of the kids that take this class have a pretty strong sports background.
Right.
Although, we do get students that don't know anything about sports, and we've got jobs for them. They can still work a camera, help with the production, and we're always open to doing shows and events that aren't sports related.
Right.
But I think the focus would be you're going to have a lot of fun, and it's really more like a job. Kind of one of my selling pitches is it's like working for ESPN rather than taking an actual class.
Right.
And then too, I've just been real lucky with the students that have, you know, come into the classroom. Mm-hmm. Not only are they interested in sports, but I've really been lucky to have a lot of kids that just really want to work hard and really want to be the best storytellers they can actually be. And to me, that's the key, because you're going to put more hours into this than you expect.
Right.
Especially if you want to get the benefit. Again, if you want to get into the field of sports broadcasting, mm-hmm. and it is a competitive field, you have to think that even now, while you're taking these classes, you're trying to outwork the competition. There's some kid at Syracuse University right now that's going to graduate, won't have near the experience that you would if you were in this program, but you've got that degree from Syracuse. That's what you have to compete against. And so you want to get as much experience as you possibly can. That's the only way you're going to get to that next level, especially when you're coming from a little community college, and ultimately you're going to compete from kids from big D1 broadcast programs. So you've got to be better than they are. And the only way you can get there is to outwork them.
Well, I'm very thankful for you and being able to run this program, because really without this, like you said, it's a very competitive field. But really, when you look at least in California, there's not that many programs that do it like Solano does it, especially at the community college level. But even at the four-year level, you look at it, there's not many schools. I mean, SF State is obviously the number one, the biggest school and local, but other schools like maybe USC, but outside of that, not many California schools have this kind of opportunity. So I'm interested in what the future in your eyes holds for this program, and even yourself. What are you planning for the future for this program and for your own career and everything?
It's kind of interesting with this program. I just kind of take it as it comes, in the sense that I'd love to keep doing this, but ultimately it just depends on the students that come through the door at the start of the semester and what they want to gain from the program. I've just been lucky, like having you and your brother Zachary the last 2 years. I mean, you guys want to do this as a career, so you're going to put the work in. In fact, I like it when the students are pushing me to do more and more events. Can we do this? What about this game? And so really it comes down to the students. As long as there is an interest from the students in this type of program, I'm going to try to keep it going, try to keep doing it. But I don't know what's going to happen in the fall. I'm losing a lot of our experienced students from the last 2 years. And so we'll see what new students we get, what their interests would be, what they want to do, and then we'll try to meet their needs to the best of my ability. I also have to kind of watch, and I'm getting up there in years. It's so funny. The first 30 years of my teaching career all focused on speech and debate. But the last 15 years have been on sports broadcasting. And it's funny, I've kind of had two roles at this college. you know, 20 years ago, you knew me as the speech and debate guy.
Right.
Now I'm more the TV kind of film guy. So it's been kind of cool having those two careers. But there's one last thing that I really want to accomplish here at Solano. Yeah. And I really want to bring journalism back. And I want to do something in communication to train and teach students to be able to get into politics and to be more involved in their democracy.
Mm.
I kind of look at my life and, you know, as a baby boomer, you know, we kind of went out and did what we wanted career-wise,
yeah,
just hoping that other people would get into government, make sure everything's running. And I don't know how successful that's been when you look at, you know, you can see democracy eroding in certain places. You see a lot of freedoms maybe being dialed back. And so I think it's important for this generation to know how to bring about social change. And I just think it works a whole lot better if you can do it by operating within the existing system. And so my last couple of years of teaching, I want to focus more on political communication, teaching young people, like, how do you run a campaign?
Mm-hmm.
How do you run for office? Once you're in office, like, what are the expectations and how do you maneuver around and work together with other folks, conflict resolution, so that you really have more of a say in the country that you live in? And I look at Solano, I look at Solano County, I look at the community college here, one of the most diverse counties in the United States, and it works.
Yeah,
I get in the classroom, there's so much diversity, but it works and everybody's working for each other. I want to get more of that into our politics. And that's the last thing I want to focus on doing. If I can still kind of keep the sports broadcasting program going on the side, cool, I'll do that. But I probably have another 5 years left in teaching, getting students involved in having more of an impact on society and the way that they're governed. That's kind of the last thing that I want to do before I hang them up.
Yeah, I think it's interesting. It seems at a young age, a lot of us have aspirations of getting into government. You know, everybody is like, oh, I could be the president. I could do these government roles. But at some point, it sort of gets lost, I think, in the educational system and throughout that. So I'm really excited for you to not only bring a journalism program to Solano, because, I mean, I'm technically a journalism major, but we don't have a journalism program here.
We don't have a school paper.
We don't have a school paper. We don't have, yeah, there's the journalism program.
Come on, Solano.
Has lost its way within the last few years. All right, one last question, and I'll let you get out of here. So when everything is over, your time here at Solano, when you retire as a professor, what are you going to reflect on and be most proud of?
Well, I always tell my students, I give the same little spiel at the end of the semester of my public speaking classes, and I always tell students, look, you want to figure out your why. Why are you going to do what you want to do? Are you going to do it for money? Are you going to do it because, hey, it's a job I really like? Is it about that title?
Mm-hmm.
You know? And what I try to embark upon the students is, all that really matters is when your life is over, they throw you in the ground, throw dirt on your face, and go back to the church and eat potato salad. All that really matters is what kind of impact did your life have on the lives of others? Because you existed, how are other people better off? And that's what I really try to impart to each and every student. Look, if you want a successful life, make a difference in the lives of others.
Wow, that's powerful. Well, that's all the time we have for. Thank you so much.
Well, hang on, Cameron.
Yeah.
We do have time for one more thing. One of the reasons why I wanted to do this interview. You are graduating from the sports broadcasting program. We have graduation on Thursday. I know you won't be there.
Yeah.
And so I wanted to officially award Cameron Anderson with his certificate of achievement in sports broadcasting. You have more than earned it.
Wow, thank you so much.
Oh, I can hear you clapping in the background, big brother. I'm not done. So I want you to come on out here, all right? Just maybe as you go by the camera, zoom it back just a little bit so we don't cut your head off.
It wasn't me clapping, though.
And I want to give you your certificate, too.
Somebody was.
Folks.
Oh, I'm too tall.
This is Zachary Anderson. Hello. This is Cam's older brother. You don't see him as much in front of the camera, but everything that we've done in the last 2 years is a result of this gentlemen right here, Zachary Anderson and Cameron. You guys have done so great for the program. Zach?
Thanks.
Congratulations. You know, I figured up the hours that you guys have produced in the last 2 years here. 372 hours of content.
Wow.
You called 76 games. And then we have a ton of other shows. Who's back there clapping? That's not Jacob, is it?
That's Blake.
Okay.
Yeah. He is.
I had Jacob Ebert. He's the third person graduating. Jacob, you're not here, but I got your certificate right here for you. So I just wanted to get you guys your certificates. I appreciate so much that you guys have done for the program. And it's going to be tough for kids to follow that next year because I've really been spoiled having you two for the last 2 years. I really appreciate the impact you guys have made on the program. You've really made a mark here.
Well, I really appreciate you. I mean, none of this could have been possible. I still remember when I came in the summer in 2021 and I was just coming out of high school. You know, I was injured. I didn't know what my baseball career was going to be. That's all I wanted to be growing up was a baseball player. I had no clue what else I wanted to be until I stepped into the old studio, really not that old, but the old studio, and met you, and I know you immediately instilled some confidence in me being able to speak in front and throwing me into the fire right away. I still remember when I didn't show up to class, the class before our first broadcast of the semester, and I was really worried I wasn't going to be able to announce because you said, you know, maybe you'll do the second half, and then we get to the field, and immediately it's basically just me and you. That was your only option as a color commentator, and then from there, just ran with it. And
what impressed me about that first game is, based on what you were adding to the broadcast, I knew you did your homework. And yeah. So I thought, hey, maybe I just kind of read this kid wrong. You know, I was thinking maybe he's not going to put the work in. That's why I wanted to be strict with you, because yeah. I wanted you to understand the work that it takes. And then, boy, after that, boy, I think you and Zachary have logged more hours than, other than McKenna Guerrero, than anybody else who's been in this actual program. And Cameron, you have the ability to be a big time broadcaster. It's just going to be a matter of you getting that break. And it might be a break where you have to work a camera, but you just keep working because you can do this. Now, sometimes when we have enough people out at the baseball field, we're doing a game, I'll come back to the studio to work on stuff and I'm listening to the game. And I enjoy listening to you as a broadcaster. So you got the skills to pay the bills. It's just keep working hard. You get that one opportunity. And Zachary is already working in the field. He's got two jobs in sports or TV production, I should say. And so you guys are going to go far, especially once you get that first opportunity.
Well, none of this would have been possible without you. So I want to give you your flowers. And this sports broadcasting certificate is awesome. That's all the time we have for today. Extended version. This has been truly special. Thank you so much, Poff. I'm Cameron Anderson, and we're signing out here on the Solano College Sports Network for this edition of On Campus.
We out.